So I hope you can see me.
Yes, yes, clearly now.
Okay, so I'm very grateful to Dr. S.K. Pal sir for giving me the opportunity to, and I hope I'm audible as well. So I'm very grateful to Dr. S.K. Pal sir for giving me the opportunity to present this topic on the PERCON webinar, Persistent Prolonged Urinary Leak Following PCNL. And before I start, I would like to thank Dr. S.K. Pal sir for giving me the opportunity. It's very overwhelming to be in the company of such great stalwarts like Dr. S.K. Pal sir, Dr. Janak Desai, Dr. Sanjay Khadki, Dr. Maheshwari sir. So it's and others who are doing excellent PCNL and who are doing a great job. But here I am. I'm here to talk about prolonged urinary leakage. So the question is that when would, as a urologist, we all be worried about it? Because it can be irritating to the patient, because the patient is going to complain that the patient is soaked. But is it a minor irritant? And in terms of financial implications, what are the financial implications for the urologist and for the patient? Because it delays discharge and it may lead to further intervention or treatment. So here is a case scenario. The patient underwent right PCNL for renal stone. All stones clear, which was confirmed on C-arm. Nephrostomy and JJ stent was inserted as we do in our center. And the patient was shifted for post-op care. And on the post-op day one, we get the chest X-ray done and the X-ray KUB, which showed complete clearance. And the nephrostomy was clamped. And on day two, the nephrostomy was removed and the patient was prepared. He was told that now he would be sent home. But at that time, the patient started having prolonged urinary leakage when we removed the periurethral catheter. So what to do? So how to resolve periurethral catheter following PCNL? When is the time to intervene? When we think that we have to intervene for prolonged urinary leakage? So usually some sort of intervention is tried after 48 hours. We have to do certain investigations, and the investigations are, we like to do a repeat X-ray KUB just to see whether the position of the stent is perfect or not. Because in some of the cases we have seen, in one instance we had, when the tip of the stent, the upper tip of the stent came out when we removed the nephrostomy, the tip came out with the nephrostomy through the tract, and that was causing the leakage. Unfortunately, I don't have that photograph to show to you, otherwise I could have showed it. So the other thing, rarely we do an ultrasound KOB, and CT KOB is very rare, we hardly do this. If we have to look into the cause and the etiology of prolonged urinary leakage, and then we have to give some medications or try some maneuvers or intervention to solve the problem. So thank you, Dr. S.K. Pal sir, for this slide. And the etiology most likely is due to obstruction, which is caused by residual stone fragments in the kidney. It could be matrix, blood clots, or pus flakes in the system, or it could be a transient urethral edema. So what is the management? Management will vary as per our practice, because it depends on what the urologist prefers. Because some urologists only put one external nephrostomy tube. Some urologists put an internal tube, like they put a double J stent, or some even put a open-ended ureteric catheter. Some like to put both, like in our center, we put both a double J stent and we put a nephrostomy tube. And some, like today, the fashion is towards totally tubeless PCNL, so some people are putting neither. So the practice is, as we have already discussed, that we put a stent and a nephrostomy after complete stone clearance. And then we follow it up with investigations, and then if everything is all right, we clamp the tube and then we remove the nephrostomy followed by the catheter and we send the patient home. So even because we put a stent in situ, the rate of prolonged urinary leakage in our practice is low, even though we haven't done a formal study. If we are sure that there is nothing in the system, then at times we just put a urostomy bag over the nephrostomy tract site and we send the patient home and we keep in touch with the telephone contact. But basically what we have to do if there is prolonged urinary leakage is that we have to identify and remove all the probable destruction, as we showed in the slide beforehand. We have to flush the tract through the nephrostomy tube and we have to provide free drainage. If like some people only put a nephrostomy tube, then in that case, we have to put a stent and the stent has to be right from the calyx till the bladder. There has to be continuous bladder drainage, which is, that means the patient has to be on catheter. And if the, if still the prolonged urinary leakage does not resolve, then we have to think of other causes, which we'll discuss in subsequent slides. So medications, if the patient is on catheter, if you're worried about stent reflux, then we can give anticholinergics. Some people like to add alpha blockers. And while I was going through the literature, I came across one or two papers where the people have given desmopressin to treat prolonged urinary leakage following renal surgeries. But we haven't tried this in our setting. So some people earlier, in one of the studies where people don't put a stent, what they do is that they take the patient back to the theater. They like to do a nephrostogram. And if they are convinced, then only they take the nephrostomy tube out. But I don't know whether this practice is still relevant, because our theaters are very busy, and we do. And since we put a stent, we don't have to follow this practice. But even if you are not putting a stent, probably we would not do this practice because of the paucity of the theater space. The only reason some people don't like to put a stent is because of this, that some patients will go home and they will not come back, and later on there'll be the problem of forgotten stent, as was evident in few of our cases. So what are the points to ponder? Incidence of prolonged urinary leakage. What is the literature available on this topic? Is there any difference in prolonged urinary leakage following nephrostomy tube caliber? What is the incidence of prolonged urinary leakage in tube versus tubeless, either with stent in situ or totally tubeless? What is the impact of tissue sealants on prolonged urinary leakage? And finally, we look at some unusual causes of prolonged urinary leakage. So incidence varies as per the criteria selected. That is the one of the earliest papers on this topic is from Tefekli et al., who looked at urinary leakage, and they considered urinary leakage less than 12 hours. And they said that it was a grade 2 complication and the incidence was 4%. And they had to put double J stent in another 4% of patients due to persistent urinary leakage. And that they considered it to be Clavien grade 3, a complication. So again, this is a weakness of Clavien complication, how you grade this complication, and it can vary between grade 1 to grade 3. And the complication rate changes. Thus, at what point is the cutoff for the prolonged urinary leakage taken? So the most important paper from my point of view on this topic is one paper from Turkey, which was published in World Journal of Urology in 2011, where they looked at prolonged urinary leakage as the main complication. And they detected prolonged urinary leakage in 304 patients, which is 70%, which is very high. And they considered that if the leakage was less than 6 hours to be insignificant, but if the leakage was even more than 6 hours, they considered it to be prolonged because it delayed the discharge of the patient from the hospital. So again, saying the same thing, depending on when we do the, we keep the cutoff, that will determine what is the prolonged urinary leakage. So they looked at individual demographics of the patient. They looked at renal factors, the stone burden, and the surgical features. And ultimately, they came to the conclusion that presence of hydronephrosis and the degree of hydronephrosis impacted prolonged urinary leakage. And they speculated that the thinner parenchyma loses its compressive feature and the sealing effect, and in turn causes increased urinary leakage. And it also causes to increase the duration of the leak. And in amongst the surgical factors, they found the balloon dilatation with the Nephromax balloon, probably that was the balloon that they were using, that caused prolonged urinary leakage because there was non-intended tear in the renal parenchyma, and that also prolonged the duration of the leak. They found double J stents to be helpful as it reduced the leakage. They also found that the nephrostomy catheter diameter also caused prolonged, if the diameter was bigger, then it caused more leakage. And if the duration of the nephrostomy tube was more than 3 days, that caused prolonged urinary leakage. So these were some of the factors they looked into the study. So another study was by Binbe et al. And they found that stone size, stone complexity, and residual fragments caused prolonged urinary leakage. And I'm very thankful to Dr. Pankaj Maheshwari, sir, for sharing a paper, which is still under review. And in this paper, Dr. Pankaj Maheshwari, sir, finds that significant hydronephrosis, cortical thinning, and if the puncture is through the middle or lower calyceal tract, these are the causes of prolonged urinary leakage. And in this paper also, he agrees that the duration of the nephrostomy tube and the size of the nephrostomy tube are likely causes of prolonged urinary leakage. So what do the guidelines have to say about prolonged urinary leakage? Unfortunately, there is not enough data in the guidelines on this topic. Long back, and it is one of the most important papers by Dr. Pankaj Maheshwari, sir, he has looked at the impact of nephrostomy tube on prolonged urinary leakage. And in this, he found that he compared patients who had 28 French nephrostomy tube versus those who had 9 French pigtail catheter placed. And he found that pigtail catheter was reduced the duration of leakage simply because patients could be discharged home earlier. And he felt that the tract collapses around the thinner catheter, and it reduces the prolonged urinary leakage. Again, another paper, very important paper from the Nadiad group. And again, the same thing, they also came to the same conclusion that the patients who had a stent in situ or patients who had a 9 French nephrostomy tube, they fared better in terms of prolonged urinary leakage compared to those who had a large tube. Tissue sealants have not been looked into from the point of view of prolonged urinary leakage. They were mainly looked from the point of view of hemorrhage. So there's not much literature on this topic from the point of view of tissue sealants. So coming to the some unusual causes of prolonged urinary leakage, the most of the three most unusual cause, the most common cause of nephrotic cutaneous fistula, which leads to prolonged urinary leakage, is xanthogranulomatous pyelonephritis. That can be the cause. Since this is a foreign paper, they kept tuberculosis of the kidney as a second cause, but probably in our country, tuberculosis of the kidney would probably be the first cause of prolonged urinary leakage. And the third cause is fistula formation after surgery, which means that if the kidney has undergone multiple procedures, for example, multiple PCNL procedures, or the kidney has undergone open pyelolithotomy followed by PCNL, and then the function of the kidney is compromised, ultimately these kidneys can cause prolonged urinary leakage. So in the first, in the current slide, you can see that there is a fistulous tract, and ultimately it turned out to be tuberculosis. And there are case reports on this topic as well. In this current slide, you can see that there is a nephrocutaneous fistula, and this lady underwent multiple PCNLs, and due to which the function of the kidney was reduced. She had continuous leakage, and ultimately nephrectomy had to be done for this kidney. So the take-home message is that the variables which impact prolonged urinary leakage are grade of hydronephrosis, the renal parenchymal thickness, the stone burden and size, the stone complexity, balloon dilatation, multiple punctures, residual stone fragments, maybe surgeon's experience, size of the nephrostomy tube, and the duration of the nephrostomy tube insertion. And the studies have found that upper calicial puncture reduces prolonged urinary leakage, and so does a double J stent insertion. So just before I mop up, there was a beautiful paper on exiting by the Arthur Smith group, in which they divided patients into three categories. They divided patients as routine PCNL, problematic PCNL, and complicated PCNL. And what they said was that the routine patients are those who have no renal collecting system injury, there is minimal bleeding, and they are stone free. So probably these patients can do with double J stent, or they can have a small bore nephrostomy tube. In our current setting, probably they can be done tubeless also. In the second group of patients, which are problematic PCNL patients, this group of patients had renal pelvis perforation, there was residual stone, and there was need for stage nephrolithotomy, and they had infected stones or edema of the UPJ. So these patients probably need a stent as well, and they need a small or a large bore nephrostomy tube depending upon the judgment of the surgeon. And in the last group, which is the complicated PCNL, where the patient has undergone some complication intra-op, like UPJ tear, there was significant bleeding, there was injury to adjacent organs, or there were multiple dilated tracts, more than two tracts. Here, the advice was to put a large bore nephrostomy tube. In our setting, most likely we would put in the last two groups, we would put both double J stent as well as a nephrostomy tube, and the size would depend on the complication. So to conclude, at present, the Clavien grading for prolonged urinary leakage is confusing. Prolonged urinary leakage should only be graded as a complication if there is urine leak from a nephrocutaneous fistula, or it needs secondary intervention due to some sort of leak, like we have to put a double J stent in situ. And obviously, further studies are required on this topic to look at the impact of prolonged urinary leakage on the new modalities of PCNL, like ultra-mini and mini-PCNL, supine and prone PCNL, and the incidence in children versus adults. So more research is needed on this topic. So in the end, my heartfelt thanks to Dr. S.K. Pal, sir. This is a photograph of Dr. S.K. Pal, sir, when he came to Lucknow to demonstrate and teach PCNL to us and our residents. And this is an image that I have of Dr. S.K. Pal, sir, in my mind, because he's always teaching, always pushing, and always doing PCNL. He's very focused on that. And at the same time, I'm very thankful to Dr. Pankaj Maheshwari, sir, for sharing his research, and to the INTAS team, and to the rest of the colleagues today who are with us today for the presentation. So I thank you all. And with this, I stop my sharing.